I could not. I just
thank you, Lord.
I just
thank you. Saving my soul.
I wonder why I do what I do and why I have given my life to serving Jesus and doing His will, working for Him day and night. Well, I can't explain, simple but true, and it started not too long ago when God made a change, He made a difference, placed His love deep in my soul.
A love down deep in my heart makes me want to shout and sing. A peace that only the presence of Jesus can bring.
A joy that's bubbling up ever since I made my new start.
And makes me want to tell everybody I see about this love down deep in my heart.
Though I am not fit to be a servant, Jesus made me an heir. Eternal kingdom way up in heaven, God has gone now to prepare. That's why I'll serve Him while there is still time before the day comes to depart. And what keeps me going and so determined is His love down deep in my heart.
A love down deep in my heart makes me want to shout and sing. A peace that only the presence of Jesus can bring.
A joy that's bubbling up ever since I made my new start.
It makes me want to tell everybody I see about this love down deep in my heart.
Yes,
it makes me want to tell everybody I see
about this love.
Thank you. 250. He keeps me singing. Let's all stand. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the stumbling chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath the sheltering wing. Always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. On the last, soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. As we sing, you may be seated.
Amen. It's good to be saved tonight. Amen. Good to be in church. Welcome, everybody. We're looking forward to a good evening tonight. The Lord visit with us and just spend a little time together as a church. You know, the Bible says that you should come together and we shouldn't forsake it. So it's a blessing to be here tonight. I just came back from a couple of days at a conference just in Los Angeles, and man, I got fed. I got strengthened. You know, you get all these preachers and so forth, and it was a blessing. And I just know we're going to have a good time tonight. Let's bow our heads and go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to bless our services tonight. Father, thanks again, Lord, for Your grace, Your mercy, and Your love. Thank You, Father, for being amongst us and helping us, Lord, when we need You. Lord, there's so many things, Lord, that we fall short, Lord. There's a lot of things that we not quite who we should be before Thee. But we thank You, Lord, that You love us enough to continue to work with us through the Holy Spirit, through preaching, and through our personal Bible devotions. Would You bless tonight, Lord? If there is someone here that doesn't know You as Savior, we pray they'd be saved tonight. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Torres. Let's go ahead and take our psalm books once more as we stand tonight. Turn to page number 178. Page 178, Footprints of Jesus.
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard Thee calling, come follow me. And we see where Thy footprints falling lead us to Thee. Footprints of Jesus, let make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Though they lead o'er the cold, dark mountains, seeking His sheep, or along by Siloam's fountain, helping the weak.
merits of Jesus, let's make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go. If they lead through the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lowly, serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus, let's make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go.
On the last.
Then at last, when the hirelings take us, our journey done, we will rest where the steps of Jesus and at his throne. Footprints of Jesus, let's make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go.
Man, you may be seated.
Amen. How many of you heard that song for the first time tonight? A couple of you? Yeah, it's the first time I've heard it. And just good to add another song to the repertoire. So good singing tonight. Just a couple of announcements for you. First of all, Sunday, we did a kids offering, if you remember. And good to have Myra and Manny back. Welcome back. But we did a kid offering, and $3,000 was given for that offering. So thank you, church. Tremendous, tremendous job. And that'll give us the ability to bring down the cost to every child that wants to go down to $250. And so that'll be a blessing, I know, to many parents. And so thank you so much for giving towards that. And you should be commended. And thank you so much for your soft heart. Be praying. As we gave, now let's pray and ask the Lord to work on all the summer events. If you weren't here on Sunday, we did pass out a little brochure that gave all the listing of the summer events. And so if you'd like one of those, you can grab those, put it on your fridge, and just pray that God would work during the summer to our young people. And then God and Country is right around the corner. And Sunday, we will have all the military areas back there on the little platform thing, desk that we have. And so you'll be encouraged, if you like, to grab an area. And we'll have a map. We'll have the address. We'll show you how many doors are in that area. And when it comes to military housing, what we do is we just canvass them. We can't knock them. But we can canvass them. And so if you'd like to hit a military area on Sunday, there'll be a number of tracks back there, areas. I want to encourage you to do that if you'd like to do this well. The teens, if you're a parent of a teen, the teens will have a teen activity this Saturday. And if you need a little bit more information as to what time and where, they're doing a beach outing. But if you would like some more information about that, you can see Rick Wright, who is down at building 800 tonight with our teenagers. You can ask them about that. And then just lastly, on Sunday, our ladies' class, which is our 9 o'clock hour, our Sunday school hour, will be having Sister Angie Zachary speaking this Sunday. And so if you'd like to go hear Sister Zachary, be blessed by that, I want to encourage you ladies to do so at 9 o'clock down in the ladies' class. Thanks, church.
All right, thanks, Brother Abe. Just a quick reminder in regards to God and Country. I want to remind you that if you can get into your uniform, we'd love to have you wear your uniform on God and Country Sunday. Unfortunately, I am in that category now where I can only wear my medals. So, but maybe we can work on that this next year, amen. But if you can wear a uniform, we'd like to encourage you to wear a uniform. Let's go ahead and take our psalm books as we stand one last time. Turn to page number 78. Page 78, we'll sing the first verse, and then we'll go around and greet each other.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Let's greet each other. All right, so we make our way back to our seats. We'll sing it out on the second verse tonight, page number 78.
While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
It's great singing. You may be seated. All right, the ushers are down front. This time, let's go ahead and pray for our offering tonight. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for a great week this week. We pray that you would continue on, Lord, and give us a great week, the remainder of the week. Pray, Lord God, that you would be with our church, Lord. We pray that you would bless this gift tonight, Lord. Help us to do much with it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. You know, once in a while, it's good to just hear somebody's testimony, how they got saved. And something the Lord just laid on our hearts as a staff is periodically, it'd be nice to just have a member stand up, just tell how they got saved, how God reached them, how they got involved in the church, whether it be this church or wherever church they served at when they first started. And so just periodically as a church, we'll just have just a couple minutes set aside and just kind of follow the Lord as to who to lay on our heart to get up and just give a quick testimony. And I pray that your salvation testimony never becomes old. I pray that it's something that it just stirs in your heart and burns. And so we've asked Brother Newby to come up and just give us a few minutes of his testimony. And so I pray that you enjoy it, Brother Newby. And please forgive him. He's wearing a New York Yankees tie, so just please forgive him for that. And
yep, New York, best team in baseball.
All right. All right, okay. Yeah, it's a pleasure to give my testimony. I'm a child of the 60s, if anybody, you know, remembers the 60s, growing up during the, you remember the assassinations, the Vietnam War, Woodstock, and all that. And I was a, what you would call, a hippie. I had the big afro. I don't know if anybody remembers the Mod Squad with Link with that big afro. That was me. I had the peace medallion. I had the flower shirts, the big flaring bell bottoms. And I even had blue suede shoes, just like the song says. And I grew up in the projects in New York. My mom and dad, they didn't go to church. Didn't read the Bible, didn't even know anything about the Bible, but they did the very moral values they had. But I didn't hear the gospel until I was, I think it was 23 years old when I first heard a clear presentation of the gospel. And it was during the time when I worked for the AT&T, the telephone company, at a recycling plant. What they did, everything that part of AT&T, all the scrap, line wire, telephone wires, telephone booths, telephone, you know, pay phones, switchboards, anything that had precious metals in it, and all, any type of metal, copper, came to us, and we recycled it. And so I was a driver, forklift driver, in the boxcars, and I was... They had two sections. One section was called the A section, which was the cream of the crop. You got all the easy box cars. Section B was where they had all the tough stuff that came in. You really had to work it. And I was put on the B side because I was their best driver on the forklift. They put two helpers to a box car. So my helpers, they loved working with me because they didn't have to do anything. I did everything with the forklift where the other drivers, they would drop stuff and they would have to pick it up. My helpers didn't have to do anything. So they loved working with me. And so one day they switched supervisors, and the supervisor that they put in place of the one that they let go, he had a friend. And he came up to me and says, Newby, I'm going to put... I forget his name, he said, I'm going to put him on the truck, and you're going to be a helper. And I looked at him, because I knew this guy could not drive to save his life. He couldn't drive. And so I said to him, I said, okay, are you going to pay me the same rate as a forklift driver being a helper? He said, sure, I'll do that. So I said, no argument from me, as long as I got the same pay. So I was signed a box car, and then I was standing there one morning waiting for my other helper. So this guy comes up. He was from Ohio. He had moved to New York to help a pastor build a church. And so we're standing there. We started talking, and then he said to me, he says, you know what? He said, I'm born again in Jesus, you know, in the conversation. Now, at that time, I was big into yoga. With the meditation, with the chant, with the mantra. You had to have your own mantra and everything. You know, I used to go to up in the attic, you know, try to clear your head of everything, just sit there in the lotus position like this. So I said to him, yeah, I said, well, what did you come back as? And he laughed. He said, no, I'm born again in Jesus. And so I said, oh, okay. So I let it go like that. And so the next day we started talking, and for that whole week, he told me the gospel. He explained, I had a question, he would tell me scripture verses. He never said, this is my opinion. He said, the Bible says this, the Bible says that. He showed me scripture verses. And so Friday came around and he asked, oh, well, think you want to get saved? I said, nah, I don't get saved, because that weekend we had a gig, because at the same time I was playing in a band, and what we did was I worked 8 to 5 during the day, my regular job. I worked 9 to 2 in a nightclub in Jersey. And so that was a hectic. Wouldn't recommend it. And so he goes, well, he said, you're going to be miserable all weekend. I said, thanks. And so that Monday came around, and he said, well, what do you think? You think you want to get saved? You think? Yeah. I thought about it. I said, yeah. Because, you know, one thing I realized, everything he said to me was scripture, and it was the only thing that made sense with everything that was going on at that time. It was the only thing that made sense to me. So I said, yeah, I would like to get saved. So he said, well, go behind the boxcar there. I went behind the boxcar, asked Jesus Christ into my heart. And I must have took a long time, because when I came back, he said to me, man, what took you so long? What happened? He said, were you expecting something? And I had to be honest with him. I said, yeah. I'm not, I thought I would hear, you are saved, or something like that. I said, yeah, I told him. He laughed. He got a chuckle out of that. But, you know, so I got saved. And then I think it was 2 days or the next day, the supervisor came up to me and he said, newbie, get back on the truck. You know, when I think about it, that was a divine appointment. God took me off the truck for that week to hear the gospel. Once I accepted Christ as my Savior, he said, get back on the truck. And so I joined the church, and I knew I couldn't play in the band anymore. And the thing about the saxophone player, he was going to a church, and he told me about the church. And I said to him, Craig, I said, why didn't you tell me this? You know, you were saved, and you didn't tell me. So he told me about a church. And so I went there, and that's where I met my wife. She was singing in the choir. I joined the choir, and until she decided to marry me, then I quit the choir. Anyway, but the thing about it was, when I first saw my future wife, you know, I was so nervous. I wanted to talk to her. And I said, you know, how do you talk to a Christian lady? So I'm praying. I said, Lord, I would like to meet her, but I don't know what to say. And so Saturday came around, and my father said, hey, there's somebody at the door wants to talk to you. So I went to the door, and there was this guy named Mel, and there was Ree, my wife. And Mel said to me, hey, we were just thinking, we're doing bus visits. We want to know if you want to join the bus ministry and do visits. I stood there and said, she's in front of the door. I said, sure, that was no brainer, yeah. And so that's how we met, and that's we got married. We met through serving in the bus ministry. And then my job moved out here, and so I got laid off. That job I had was at work for a year. Then I got the job I have now, and they moved out here. So that's how we wound up here. But, you know, just want to say it was the Lord that pricked my heart, you know. And I realized something, you know, it's good to give your testimony and tell people about Jesus Christ, but Back it up with scripture. That's one valuable lesson I learned, because that has more power than anything when you back it up so a person could actually see what it says in the Bible instead of your words. So that's my testimony, and it's been a fantastic ride. Amen.
Thanks, brother. Wasn't that good? That was a blessing. You open your Bibles tonight to two places, and we'll start in two places, and we'll move quickly, but Mark chapter 8, if you would. Mark chapter 8, and if you'd pick up in your other hand, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Mark chapter 8, and 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. I've known Brother Newby a long time, and he's known me for a long time, but I have never heard his full testimony like that. And so, man, it's good just to hear how somebody else got saved and what God did in their life. And so, again, periodically we'll have just a testimony or two just to keep us encouraged and maybe learn a little something about soul winning, how we should witness to others. And so, Mark chapter 8 and 1 Corinthians chapter 2. If you were not here Sunday night, I want to encourage you, get the message, get the CD. Pastor Denver in Dallas came through, and man, he let it rip, and it was just good preaching. And so if you get a chance, you weren't here, I encourage you to go back, listen to it Sunday night. You will be encouraged, and you will be blessed. Mark chapter 8, and again, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, just going to give us a thought tonight, and pray that it'll give you just something to consider. We'll start in verse number 13. The Bible says, "And he left them, and entering into the ship again, departed to the other side. Now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, neither had they in the ship with them more than one loaf. And he charged them, saying, Take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, It is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he said unto them, Why reason ye because ye have no bread? He uses this word, perceive ye not yet, neither understand, have ye your heart yet hardened?" I want to talk to you tonight on this subject, spiritual discernment, spiritual discernment. Father, I pray that you'd help us tonight as we study your word. I pray that you'd give us exactly what we need, for it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. The word discernment in the 1828 dictionary says the power of perception. It puts it this way: the errors of youth often proceed from the lack of discernment. The errors of youth often proceed from the lack of discernment. It reminded me when I read that, it reminded me of when I was a little bit younger and I was watching a baseball game and cooking Spam tacos at the same time. Maybe I had Spam tacos before. Okay, praise the Lord. God's people, they're delicious. And so I was making these Spam tacos, and I put a little grease in the pan, and watching baseball, making my tacos, watching baseball, watching baseball, cooking tacos, eating tacos. I'd eaten them, and I had sat down, and I had totally had forgotten that they had left the stove on. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm watching baseball. And sure enough, smell something, and I think, man, that smells familiar. That's a familiar smell. And dawned on me, oh no, my tacos! And so I run down the hallway. I'm living at my mom and dad's house, not yet an adult. And I run down the hallway, and immediately I see the pan, and the whole kitchen is smoking. And I grab the pan. As soon as I grab the pan, little thing of fire pops up about a foot, maybe 2 feet off the pan. And I start panicking. And immediately I think, how do you put out a fire? You use water, of course. And so I took my grease pan and I put it right under that water and I turned on that water full blast. And as you already know, that grease fire went from about 2 feet to about 10 feet. And I remember filling it up and I just thinking in my mind, my dad is going to kill me. That's all that was. I didn't care about dying. I was caring getting killed by my father. And so it all went up and it just started smoking. And I took that pan and I ran out by the grace of God and I threw it on the concrete floor and immediately it went out. And I remember going back into the house all filled with smoke. And I remember going to the ceiling and seeing it all black. And I thought, man, I got to clean this before Dad gets home. And taking that sponge and washing the ceiling and just trying to get it cleaned. And I remember it took about 2 weeks. So one day Dad looked at the ceiling and said, why is the ceiling black?
But I look back at that time and I think, man, I lacked spiritual discernment, right? Not spiritual discernment, but life discernment. I lacked an understanding, a perception of that doesn't work. You don't put out a grease fire that way. I lacked that discernment. But tonight we're not just talking about discernment, we're talking about spiritual discernment. And I want you to follow along with me, if you will. In that situation, that example that I gave you, we were just speaking about a lack of discernment. But if you lack spiritual discernment, it'll be more than just a concern of a fire that needs to be put out. Look at again with me in Mark chapter 8, if you will, and look at it again. Look what happens. Verse 13, he left them, he enters into the ship, the disciples together with him. The Bible says, verse 14, now the disciples had forgotten to take bread. Neither had they in the ship with them more than one loaf. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. He is speaking spiritually, but they are thinking carnally. He is speaking spiritually, but they are thinking carnally. You're in 1 Corinthians. Hold your place in Mark chapter 8 and flip over to 1 Corinthians, if you will. And this is a well-known scripture, but 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And if you're there, we'll read verse 14. Ready? Begin. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. The scripture just said that things that are of the Spirit of God cannot be discerned without spiritually discernment. Scripture tells us here that there is a requirement to understand what God is doing. There's a requirement to understand what God is saying, how God is directing you and I, how God is working, and the requirement is spiritual discernment. A father needs spiritual discernment to be able to send his family into a certain pathway. A mother needs spiritual discernment as she guides her children. A husband needs spiritual discernment as he guides his relationship with his wife. A leader needs spiritual discernment. A businessman needs spiritual discernment. They need God to give them that spiritual discernment. Let me make this statement. Without spiritual discernment, you will get the wrong message and direction from what God is saying or doing. Let me say that again. Without spiritual discernment, you will get the wrong message and direction from what God is saying or doing. Go back to Mark chapter 8, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. Mark chapter number 8. Jesus, again, was speaking spiritually, but they were discerning carnally. And without spiritual discernment, you and I will get the wrong message and direction from what God is saying or doing. Look at verse 16 again. And they reason among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. Jesus is not talking about bread, but they think he's talking about bread physically. He's talking about spiritually. He's talking about the doctrines of the Pharisees and the doctrine of the Sadducees and the doctrines of Herod. He's talking about a false doctrine, but they don't discern that. You remember when you were a child, you ever play that game called telephone? I remember playing that game called telephone growing up, where you would tell one person, they tell one person, they tell one person. And before you got to the end, the message was completely jumbled up. It was completely wrong. And it would be funny. You'd laugh and think, oh, that's not what we said. Here was the original saying. Unfortunately, if you and I are not spiritually discerning with God, we can misinterpret and get misdirection and get the message of God all jumbled up. And before you know it, we could be heading in the wrong direction because we lack spiritual discernment. Follow me. These folks, these disciples are told by God, don't beware of the leaven. And here's immediately what they think. Oh, we forgot to take bread. He's upset. He's rebuking us because we forgot to take bread. And if they're not careful, listen, if they're not careful, here's what they're going to do, because God's rebuking them. Guys, we got to turn back. Guys, we got to go back to where we came from, and we got to grab the bread that God is frustrated with. Listen, God is not angry about the bread. God is not frustrated with them about the bread. But because of their lack of spiritual discernment, they are pondering, reasoning among themselves whether they should turn around and go get bread. Brothers, what's the point of that? Listen, if you are not spiritually discerning in your life and understanding how God is directing you, you will take a message from God and misinterpret it. And if you're not careful, you will set a direction in your life that will not be the direction that God was intending. You understand the importance of spiritual discernment. Spiritual discernment sets you on a path and a direction which God intended. If you and I lack spiritual discernment, you can hear a message from God and not discern what God is doing and lose your direction. Well, I know I heard from God, yeah, but you interpret it in your own carnal mind and not in your spiritual mind, and because of that, you've set a wrong direction for your life. Spiritual discernment, spiritual understanding. Again, they were talking carnally, but God was speaking spiritually. When you and I lack spiritual discernment, we will say the wrong thing mentally and physically. We will think the wrong way mentally, and we will set the wrong direction. They're thinking that God's rebuking them, but He is not. And if they're not careful, they will go the wrong direction based on what their carnal mind tells them what God was saying. When a business is pointed in the wrong direction, when a church is pointed the wrong direction, when a mindset is pointed the wrong direction, it could be sourced back to a lack of spiritual discernment. Let me give you this next statement. Without spiritual discernment, you will get the wrong message, but not only that, you'll miss the right message. They lacked the they got a direction they thought from God, but what was worse than that is they missed what God was saying. When you lack spiritual discernment, you lack clarity and direction as to what God is actually saying. You believe the wrong direction, and then you set yourself in the wrong way, but you miss what God is saying and what God is doing. Let me give you another statement. The absence of spiritual discernment in a person's life will make them act and say things they would never act or say should they had spiritual discernment. In understanding a perception of what God is doing or saying in your life, this is spiritual discernment. Let me give you a statement tonight. God is ever present and ever working in your life. Let me say that again. God is ever present and ever working in your life. Here's how we go through life sometimes, and we all do it. Sometimes we go through life and we think God is kind of like, He kind of comes into my life, and then He goes, and then He comes in, almost like He goes out to lunch, and then He comes back into our life, and God goes away, and then when I have all these problems, He comes back, and He helps me with these problems. No, listen, that's not how it works. God is ever present and ever working in your life. Why is that important, Brother Abe? Because that'll give you the spiritual discernment to understand what you are dealing with your life is designed by God. And when you understand that what you're going through life is designed by God, it gives you a greater understanding to say, okay, this didn't happen by happen chance. God was not out to lunch. So God, give me the discernment to understand what is going on here so I can make the right decisions in my life. God, what is the message that you are trying to create and trying to get to me in this situation? When the Lord brings things in my life, you know what I'm asking God? God, okay, why? What am I supposed to discern why you allowed this to happen? I had a flat tire the other day, a little scooter that I bought to go back and forth from work, and the tire went flat. You know what I didn't say? Oh, stink, that my tire's flat, and I should have put more air, and here's what I said. You say, this is silly, brother. It's reality. I said, Lord, what am I supposed to discern with this tire being flat? Brother, it's just a flat tire. No, what you're saying is that God's not involved in my life, that it's just a happen chance, it just happened. No, God is involved in every element of your life. That means your coworker who won't leave you alone. That means your boss who keeps giving you trouble. That means your situation that's frustrating. Everything in life is there by design of God, but without spiritual discernment, you will become frustrated, you will become angry, you will become upset, and you will miss that God is trying to do something in your life. Spiritual discernment, interpreting it in the mind of Christ. God is ever present and working in our life. And if we do not discern what God is doing, if we do not put everything in the context that God is working in our life, it can lead to frustration. It can lead to anger. It can lead to wrath. It can lead to indifference. It can lead to discouragement. Nothing happens in my life without God allowing it. But spiritual discernment gives me the understanding to see what God is doing. Sometimes we get our spirits messed up and we start murmuring and complaining because we don't realize that God is doing something. We lack spiritual discernment. Let me just pause here. Do you know that our church went through COVID like a lot of churches went through? And if you're not spiritual discerning, all you could say is, well, this was a big fill in the blank. This was caused because these people and that people and this. No. Spiritual discernment says there's something bigger at play. God, what are you doing? What is it that I need to learn from this? How is it that our church needs to grow through this? Our pastor went down last year and had surgery and all that happened. A spiritual discerning mind says there's more to what God is doing than just a man going having a surgery and then having a stroke. It's just medical, brother. No. God is in everything, working at all times. That's spiritual discernment. That's stepping back and seeing, okay, God, what are you doing and what part do I play in this situation? Let me give you just four simple things and we'll go home tonight. How do I, Brother Aves, you made it clear that we need spiritual discernment. We need to work through it and understanding what God is doing. How do we do that? Let me give you the first one tonight. How do I become a spiritual discerning person? Let me give you the first one. Stay quiet. Stay quiet. You know the biggest trouble they're having right here? God just gave them a command and they're talking. They are reasoning. They think that God's rebuking them for not bringing bread. Can you hear the disciples? Peter, I told you to get bread. John, you were the one who was supposed to bring bread. Can you hear it? Oh, Peter, if you went and ate three loaves, you didn't need three loaves. You ate three loaves. Like, you know what they're not doing here? They're not remaining quiet. You know one of the best things you can do when you and I lack spiritual discernment? I'm frustrated, I'm angry, I'm upset, I'm discouraged, I'm depressed. Okay, you probably lack spiritual discernment in your life. And what you need is you need to step back and say, okay, God, help me to get to a place where I am just quiet. Quietness is not just from here. Quietness comes through here and through here. We think quiet one way, like I'm just going to sit down and not say anything. And yet, listen, electronics is one of the greatest things in our lifetime that has taken the ability to remain quiet away from us. Even when we sit on the couch, YouTube, Facebook, oh, look at that video, oh, look at that video, oh, look at that video, oh, look at that video. You know, we're not remaining quiet. But quiet says, listen, I'm gonna put it all down. Don't get mad at me, but you know, some of us can't even go to the restroom in a quiet place. Where's my phone? Called the rest room. But we've gone to a place where we've had to consume information. I gotta look. We get in the car, you know the first thing we have to do? We gotta turn on the radio. Can I just say this? This is something the Holy Spirit gave me today. You will not be able to hear the Holy Spirit's voice until you've learned to be quiet. God is not rude. Therefore, he will not speak over your voice and your thoughts. He will only speak when he's invited to speak. Holy Spirit, when's the last time you did this one? No TV, no thoughts, no phone. Holy Spirit, there's some kind of discernment that I need in my life that I don't have. You know, one of the things I love about our pastor is he's comfortable in quietness. I remember the very first times I used to sit down with pastor and he'd be quiet. Oh, man, it made me so uncomfortable.
pastor's not talking. Should I be talking? Should I be saying something? You know what part of that is? Part of that's learning to just listen to the Holy Spirit. And it requires quietness. Lord, help me to be quiet. Go to Mark chapter 9. I'll show you this an example. You're in Mark chapter 8. Go one chapter over. Mark chapter 9. You remember the transfiguration. Peter's taken up at the transfiguration. I got to hurry. In Mark chapter 9, verse number 2, he says, "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth up into an high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining, exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus." So you know this story. You've heard it before. This is incredible happening. If you don't, go back and read it again. But for sake of time, I got to rush through. Look at verse number 5. "And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. And let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee and one for Moses and one for Elias." Can I say this? Peter is gabbing his mouth because he doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know what to say. Matter of fact, look at verse number 6. "And Peter answered and said these things," verse 6, sorry, "for he wist not," the word wist means to perceive, "he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid." He's seeing all this happen, and here's what he's thinking: "Oh, I gotta say something." He doesn't have spiritual discernment right now. So he says something off the wall that doesn't even make sense. Jesus doesn't even acknowledge what he says. He just says it, and the Bible tells us that he said it because he lacks spiritual discernment. But wait a minute. This is a time for Peter to be quiet. Why is God doing this? Because if you know your scripture, if you go to 2 Peter chapter 1, Peter begins to write his own book. And as Peter begins to write his own book, the Holy Spirit says, "You remember what happened with you on the Mount of Transfiguration? Yes, Lord. I want you to write about how that was impactful and that was powerful, but there is a more sure word of prophecy, and that is the word of God." In other words, Peter just needs to be quiet here and just kind of sit and observe and discern what's going on, because later in life, God's going to say, "Okay, you remember that thing you observed back then? Now is the time to use it." In other words, time and quietness is going to give Peter the ability to have spiritual discernment for what he's seen. But he has to learn to be quiet in order to become spiritually discerning. What he's saying is, there are times where you lack spiritual discernment. You know what the best thing you and I can do? It's quietness. "God, I don't understand this. This doesn't make sense. It's a little frustrating, a little concerning. But God, you're not giving me any discernment in this area. So Lord, I'm just going to remain quiet until you provide discernment." Brother Abes, I want to have spiritual discernment. How do I do it? Quietness. Quietness. Let me give you another one. Not only does he want us to be quiet, but the Lord also wants us to observe. If we are wondering where God's voice is in our life, we should start with remembering that the Holy Spirit will not speak over our own voice. We need to remain quiet. You know what's wonderful about the altar call? It's a great place to be quiet. I pray that when you hear preaching, I pray that in the piano's playing, I pray that you just say, "Lord, what is it that I needed to learn from this? God, why did you bring me here today? God, did I miss it? I didn't hear your voice. Did I miss it, God?" Can I just say this? I'm not trying to be rude or unkind. The altar is a place, and the quietness of the altar call is a place where you and I just focus in on the voice of God. It's not time to think, "Oh, I got to get out of here. I got to go pick up the kids. I got to go get lunch." Lord, what is it that you're trying to speak to me on? A quietness. Spiritual discernment comes from quietness. Let me give you another one. Spiritual discernment comes from observation. Observation. Like what, Brother Abe? Quickly go, if you would, to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. You're in Mark. Go to Luke. Luke chapter 2, one book over. Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. And I want you to read with me verse number 19, if you could. Verse number 19, let's read it nice and loud. Ready? Begin. "But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart." God is going to give Mary spiritually discernment because of two things. One, the word "kept" in her heart means observe. There's things going on with Jesus. There's the angels that show up.
And Mary steps back and saying, I'm going to observe. I'm going to ponder. I love the word ponder here. It means to throw together in the mind, to lay them out in the mind, to observe, to consider. You don't have to turn to this, but in Genesis 37, Joseph tells his dream. He gives the dream, and immediately these brothers get angry. You know the story. But the Bible says this about his dad, Jacob. He says this, and his brothers envied them, but his father observed the saying. Observation gives us the time to see patterns. And when God brings something negative into my life multiple times, I should step back and be spiritually discerning. Let me tell you one way that God works with me. Something negative happens again and again and again, and it's frustrating. Here's what I'm doing. Okay, God, I'm not getting it, Lord. But you keep bringing the same situation over and over and over again. God, what is it that I'm supposed to learn here? God, how am I supposed to grow through this? God, I don't want to take the test again because obviously I'm not passing it, Lord. God, give me discernment. You know what that takes? It takes observation. One of my favorite verses in the Bible, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust the Lord with all thine heart and lean not into thine own understanding. But here's the word, in all thy ways acknowledge. You know what the word acknowledge means? It means to discern God in your pathway. You know what that's going to take? Observation. Lord, help me to observe, take time away, and to see what you are doing here. That will give you spiritual discernment when you and I observe the Lord. Acknowledge. And now let's go back to Mark 8, and we're almost done tonight. Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8. I want you to notice the response of the Lord. Mark chapter 8. Look what he says in verse number 17. And when Jesus knew it, he saith unto him, why reason ye because ye have no bread? Perceive ye not yet, neither understand? Have ye your heart yet hardened, having eyes see not, and having ears hear ye not? And do ye not remember? You know what he's just told them? Observe. Remember. He just told them, if you would just take time to step back and consider what just happened, you wouldn't be arguing amongst yourselves. If you would have just observed, how do we know he's telling us that? Look at verse number 19. When I break the five loaves among the 5,000, and how many baskets full fragments took ye up? They saith them to 12. And when the seven among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they said seven. You know what Jesus is doing? He's saying, listen, look at this. You remember you're arguing about how I'm rebuking you for not bringing bread. Do you remember when I took the bread and I broke it and I fed all the folks there? Yes. Do you remember how many baskets you had? Yes. You know what he's saying? He's saying, step back and observe. You lack discernment, spiritual discernment, because you're not stepping back and seeing the greater picture of what God is doing. So often people are frustrated and angry, and what about this, and this election we lost, and this thing we lost, and this is a mess in my life, and this happened, and that happened, and they take God out of the equation of their life, and all they truly need is some spiritual discernment to realize that God is doing something greater in their life, and if they would just step back and say, ah, okay, this is what God did. You know what the beauty of quietness is? The beauty of quietness and observation gives you the time to step back and to say, okay, this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened. And you step back and then you say, okay, God, put it all together for me. Help me understand what is happening here. God, give me the spiritual discernment. And this is exactly what he's doing. Do you know why Jesus is talking? Do you know who's not talking? The disciples. In other words, they were quiet. God is having them now observe what has happened. And now here's what they're going to do. They're going to listen to God. You know where you and I grab spiritual discernment from? Is when you and I take the time to listen to the spiritual authority in our life. Jesus is the spiritual authority in their life, and they're listening to the word. Give them discernment as to what he's talking about. You know, the greatest thing you can do when you lack spiritual discernment is get the word of God out. God, I lack discernment on what to do. I'm a father, and I lack clarity. God, speak to me through your word. Give me clarity. The number one thing, before you open up the word of God, almost every time when I'm taking my Bible, I'm asking God before I read one page, God, open up your word to me. God, I need discernment and direction for my life. In other words, they're giving the attention to God and saying, God, speak to us. Give us clarity to what you just said. And quietness with observation, with an attention to the word and the spiritual authority is going to give them discernment as to what God is saying in their life. You know what I'm thankful for? I'm thankful for spiritual authorities in my life. I had a man today I was on the phone with, and I just said, hey, brother, I just want to let you know, pastor, I said, I just want to let you know you're a lot farther down the road than I am. I'm just a young puppy just trying to figure all this out. I said, preacher, I just want to let you know you have authority and rights. If you feel like I'm doing something wrong, or if you feel like there's some kind of thing that you would advise me on or something that I need to learn from, please, you have full authority to correct me. You have full authority to tell. You know what that is? That's opening up my heart so I don't lack spiritual discernment. It's allowing a spiritual authority. Can I just ask, is there anybody in your life that has spiritual authority to come to you and to say, hey, brother, hey, sister, probably not the right spirit, probably not the right attitude. You're about to make this big decision. Does anybody in our life have the right to come into our life and say, you're not thinking right? You know where spiritual discernment comes? It comes partially for letting spiritual authority speak into our life. And we got to get past the pride that's in our heart that thinks that we know everything and we have the way and we have the direction. You know, as an assistant pastor here at the church, I'm thankful, and please don't all rush me at once, but I'm thankful for different members in the last year and a half that I've been here at the church. I'm thankful for certain members who've come in with a humble heart and a meek spirit, have talked to me, said, Brother Aves, I don't know if you know, but you said a little something here. You did, and I just, man, that's not what I meant at all. I'm so sorry. You know what that gave me? A little spiritual discernment to allow them to come and speak into my life and say, hey, you probably didn't mean this, Brother Aves, but you did this. And you know what I love about that? I love that it helps me grow. It gives me spiritual discernment, stuff that I cannot see. How do I get spiritual discernment, Brother Aves? We stay quiet. We step back and observe what God is doing. God, what are you doing here? And we listen to the word of God, but not just the word of God. We listen to spiritual authorities. Then I want to close it out tonight and turn, if you would, to the book of Matthew, and we'll be done tonight. Matthew. I told you just a simple message tonight, but Matthew chapter 16. I pray that you would just take this and maybe consider it in your own life. There's a place of frustration or a place of depression or discouragement. Maybe we lack just a little bit of spiritual discernment. But look at Matthew chapter 16. It is the same story, but it gives us the end of the story. Look at verse number 11. He says, how is it that ye do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees? Look what the scripture says. Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. After they stayed quiet, after they observed, after they listened to the word of God, but also to their spiritual authority, and time had passed. Let me give you the last one, time. You know what sometimes spiritual discernment takes? Time. Things just have to, I don't understand this. Give it time. When Jacob's hearing his son Joseph saying, oh, there's going to be these sheaves, and you're going to bow down to me, and all these things are going to happen. And his dad is thinking about the saying, it's going to be years until he realizes what his son is talking about. When it comes to pass, he's going to say, ah, that's what that was about. Until you get the spiritual discernment and the time has passed, stay quiet. Observe. Listen to the word. But in time, God says, now I'm going to pull back and I'm going to show you what I was doing. Can I just say this? There are so many times in my life where I lack spiritual discernment. But when I stayed quiet, when I stepped back and I observed, when I stayed sensitive to my spiritual leaders and the word of God, in time, God has shown me discernment as to what is going on in my life and what is going on in the life around me. When they come to this end, the scripture says, then they understood. In other words, they finally had spiritual discernment. May God help us to be people when we come against something, something frustrating, something difficult. God, I'm frustrated at this. I'm angry. I'm upset. I'm depressed. I'm discouraged with this. God, help me to stay quiet. Help me to observe what you're doing. Help me to listen to your voice, the word of God, and to listen to spiritual authorities. And in time, God, would you give me spiritual discernment? May God help us to be a people that are spiritually discerning. Let's pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Very simple message. Very simple message tonight. Maybe if you would just log this one away and just ask the Lord, God, I'm doing good right now, but maybe there's coming a difficulty or a challenge in my life that I just need spiritual discernment on. May this log away in your mind. Maybe there's somebody that you know who's dealing with a hard time. They're kind of frustrated, they're upset. Maybe you could give them this word of encouragement. Just stay quiet for a little bit. Let the Holy Spirit speak into your life. Be discerning. Be patient. Let God speak. May we stop looking at things carnally. And may we look at them through spiritual eyes. May the Lord give us spiritual discernment. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I wonder if there's anybody in here tonight that would say, Brother Abe, I talked about spiritual discernment. You can't begin to have spiritual discernment to become a child of God. What's a child of God? It means that the day you die, you know you're going to be with God. If you were to die right now, do you know 100% sure that you would go to be with God? You can know. Would you raise your hand and say, Brother Abe, please pray for me. If I had to die right now, I don't know if I'd go to heaven or hell, but would you please pray for me? Would you raise your hand so I can pray for you? Anybody like that in here tonight? Don't know Jesus as my Savior. Don't know if I'd go to heaven or to hell, but I'd like to know. Would you pray for me? I believe that means we're children of God tonight. Would the Lord help us to be spiritual, discerning Christians? Take your time, please.
Amen. Thanks for that message, Brother Abe. Again, I can't believe that God and Country is just a couple of weeks away. Just be asked that you could be thinking about who you might invite as we get ready with this campaign for our God and Country Sunday. If you're praying about God and Country, the theme this year is prayer for America. America really needs prayer right now. Amen. And as I read the narrations of the program that go along with the music, they're all quotes from our founding fathers and quotes from the Bible. So powerful, powerful message. Think about who the Lord might place on your heart to invite to God and Country. That'd be on June 26th. Let's go ahead and stand. We'll be dismissed. Lord, we come to you again. Thank you for a great night tonight, Lord, in church. Thank you for the privilege to be able to be here. We pray that you give us a good week, Lord, the remainder of the week. Bring us back here on Sunday, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You're dismissed.